Hi everyone, welcome to our lecture on binary search trees. So today we'll actually continue our implementations of data structures that we started the last week with implementing lists and queues and stacks. We implemented array lists and then we implemented linked lists. And in the linked lists, we used the concept of a node and reference to other nodes in the data structure. Today, we continue this idea for binary search trees and trees in general. And then we'll learn how to do balanced trees in the future lecture on AVL trees. And then basically we'll discuss more types of trees. So the objective today is to actually learn how to implement a tree and then in particular binary search trees. And we'll see the difference between binary search trees and heaps. Heaps are just a specific case of a tree which can be stored in an array because they are a complete tree. But binary search trees have a different property that instead that the parent is greater than both nodes, children, as we had for heaps, for binary search trees, the parent node is greater than the left tree, than the left child, and the parent is less than its right child. And the advantage of binary search trees is that you can basically find a node in a tree by just going over a single branch. Because for every parent, you can basically decide if it's greater or less than the element that you are looking for, and then you take the left branch or the right branch. So we'll learn how to represent binary trees using linked data structures, basically a node with two references to the left and the right child. Then we'll know the property of binary search trees that I mentioned earlier. Then we'll learn how to search an element in a binary search tree, how to insert an element in a binary search tree, traverse the elements in a binary search tree with different ways of traversal, pre-order, post-order, in-order, depth-first search, and breadth-first search. Then we'll learn a more complicated algorithm on deleting elements from a binary search tree. And we'll learn the complexity of all of these operations, how to basically do all of these operations on binary search trees. The next lecture, we'll discuss the displaying of a binary search tree using JavaFX. We will create various types of iterators to traverse the binary tree. And then we'll implement Huffman code encoding for compressing data using a binary tree. So today we'll basically have a basic implementation that you can basically use for inserting, traversing, and deleting elements from binary search tree. So we talked a little bit about binary trees when we talked about heaps. A binary tree is a hierarchical data structure. It's either empty, null. So basically you have a reference to the root, but the root is null. That reference is called the root variable. And there are two distinct subtrees of a parent if such subtrees exist. Those are the left subtree and the right subtree. The root of the left subtree is called the left child of the node. So basically 55 is the left child of 60. And the right subtree, the root of the right subtree is called the right child of that node, of the parent node. A node without children, any children, not neither left nor right, is basically called a leaf. And there is no requirement for standard trees, binary trees, if they have a right child or if they have a left child. So there are nodes that basically have just the left child. There are nodes that have just the right child. There are nodes that do not have any children, like leaves, like A in this example. Or there are nodes that have both children, left child and right child. A special type of binary trees are binary search trees. And they come with basically two properties. The left subtree is basically the left child is always less than the parent, than the value of the parent. And the value stored in the right child is always greater than the value in the parent. So for instance, if you look at these two trees that we had in the previous example, they are binary search trees because for every node, if you iterate over all the nodes in the tree, you would see that the left child is less than the parent. So for instance, 55 is less than 60 and 100 is greater than 60. The right child is greater than its parent. Now there is also the requirement that all of the nodes on the left subtree must be less than the parent, and all of the nodes for every node, all of the nodes on the right subtree are greater than the parent. So it's just the property that the children are within those requirements, less and greater is not enough. Because basically if you look in the right branch of the left child, it has a greater value than the child. In essence, it could be also greater than the root of the tree, the parent of the child, okay? So this type of special trees are called binary search trees. And again, the idea is that all of the nodes in the left subtree are less than the value in the parent, and all of the nodes in the right subtree are greater than the value of the parent, and this applies to every single node in the graph. So it doesn't apply only to the root, it applies to every node. Now, how do we represent binary trees, first of all? A binary tree is basically represented using linked nodes. So the tree node class, parameterized for the element of the type E, contains, first of all, the element of the type E, but then it contains two references. The left, reference to a left tree node of the same kind, and a reference to a right tree node of the same kind. So as we had, if you remember from linked lists, node had an element and link, which was the next element, basically the next, the link to the next element. In the case of binary trees, they are more like double linked lists. They basically have two references to the left child and the right child, okay? And this can be either a separate class that represents a node, but in most cases it's just a static inner of a class of the tree class. So basically it can represent the nodes for that specific tree.
Professor?
Go ahead.
So you can't represent a binary like tree in an array?
Not every binary tree. You can only represent heaps in an array. So the property with heaps is that they are compact. So you have basically all of the nodes up to the last level. The last level may not be complete, but the nodes in that last level are packed to the left-hand side.
Oh, okay. So binary trees don't have that like restriction.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that's why we can't represent binary trees in an array, because we would not know what we skip unless they are complete. That basically means they're packed to the left in the last level. Okay. If they would be packed into, so if you know that your binary tree is packed, that it's complete, then you can represent basically them in an array, because you can represent any tree in such a way, as long as it is complete. But binary trees by definition are not complete. In fact, they are not even balanced. So we don't know if they are all the nodes or a single branch and so on. In fact, I can build a couple of binary trees that if you look at them, you would see that they are definitely not compact. So for instance, I want to insert 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. So you see that this only creates one branch, because for every node, its child is greater than, the right child is greater than the parent, the right child is greater than the parent, and so on. This is a correct binary search tree. The only problem is that it's basically only on one branch. If we would insert these elements in a different order, so let's rerun this program, and we insert, let's say, 3 first, and then we insert 2, and then we insert 1, and then we would insert, let's say, 4, So this creates a more balanced tree. This can be represented in an array because you would have 3 as the first element, 2 and 4, 1 and so on. It's kind of like traversing this tree in breadth first order. You first read the first, the root, then the next level, then the next level completely and so on. Okay, so let's continue a little bit about binary trees and we'll actually see some code. So let's say that we do have such a data structure like a tree node, and now we want to represent a binary search tree and search in it. The binary search tree have that property that I mentioned earlier, that the entire left subtree is less than the every node, that for every node, the left subtree is less than it, and the right subtree is greater than it. So we have that property for every node in the tree. So it doesn't matter that you look at 60 or at 55 or at 100, the entire left subtree is less than it, the entire right subtree is greater than it. Then searching for an element is actually done in the depth, in the height of the tree. Because you are looking, let's say, for 70. 70 is greater than 60, you go on the right branch. 70 is less than 100, you go on the left branch. 70 is greater than 67, you would go on the right branch, but since that is null, you can declare 70 is not in the tree. If you are looking for 57, for instance, you would look, 57 is less than 60, 57 is greater than 55, you go on the right branch, and then you find 57. So searching in a tree is actually done in the depth of the tree. You start from the root, the current node is assigned the root. While the current node is different than null, that basically means that you are still seeing a node with a cursor. If the element is less than the current.element, the element in the that was passed as an argument, the key, is less than the element in the current node, then you continue on the left-hand branch of that tree. So current is assigned current.left. If the element is greater than the element in the current node, then you would assign to current the current.right. You go on the right branch of that tree, of that node. Else, it means that the two elements are equal. The key that was passed is equal with the current element that we are looking at. So you return true, and you basically found that element. If you find that the current is equal with null, that means you went on a branch and you got to a leaf, and in that leaf you don't have the element that you were looking for, then you return false, meaning that the element is not in the tree. So searching for an element is quite cheap. You basically just iterate through with the root from the root on one single branch. You continue with current and you find the element. If it's there, you don't find it if it's not there. Inserting is a little bit more complicated. So if the binary tree is empty, you create a root node with the new element. It has left and right, both of them initialized to left to null, and you basically finish the insertion. The root is now a tree with a single node. Otherwise, we want to insert the element as a leaf in the correct place in the tree. So we are basically trying to locate the parent node for this new element. You basically continue down in the tree until you find the leaf that would be the parent, either that is greater or less than the node that we are trying to insert, and that specific child is null. So you start by initializing the current variable with the root of the tree. If the new element that you want to insert is less than the current element, then the current node becomes the left child of the tree, so current would be current.left, and you continue recursively, you continue this loop until you find the parent for the new element. If the new element is greater than the current element, then the current node becomes the right child of the parent, and you continue again recursively, so current is assigned current.right, and you try again, compare the element with the element that you are basically with the key that you want to insert in the tree. So in essence, you do an algorithm like this one, which basically what it does, it starts from the root. So first of all, if the root is null, if the tree is empty, the root will be assigned a new tree element, and you yes, binary trees cannot have duplicates. So if it's the same, you basically return false, you couldn't insert it. If that specific child, if the current is null, then the parent will be assigned the child that corresponds to that element. So binary, yes, Darren, you're right. Binary search trees cannot contain duplicates. So again, if the tree is empty, if the root is null, the root is assigned a new tree node for that element, and we basically return. Else, we try to locate the parent node, so the current is assigned the root. If the current is different than null, then if the element value is less than the value in the current element, so basically in our case, this element is E. If E is less than the value in current.element, then the parent is equal with current, the current is equal with current.left. If the element value is greater than the value in the current element, then the parent is assigned with current, and we go on the right branch. The current will be current.right. So we always keep this, the parent, reference to the parent node, so we don't basically lose it. Else, it basically means that the current element is equal with the current.element. So we return false because there is a duplicate. Now this is pseudocode. So if you really want to have this as normal code, you would use correct variables and also declare the parent variable. So this element would be the element.current. We have to define the parent. So parent is, and actually we have to define current. So this would be node for the type E. Current is the root, and parent, in this case, let's just assign it with the same current, but you can start with null because it will be set in the next step anyway. And we are here on a branch where we basically, the root is different than null. So let's do the same here. So if E is greater than current.element, then we go on the right branch. And finally, we basically, if we found the position and the current was not equal with null, so current now is null, if the element E is less than parent element, then the parent.left is a new tree node for that element. Let's call it element. Then we can basically use it everywhere as is. If otherwise, it means that it's the right child. So we basically assign it as the right child. And in either case, we return true, either that we created a new tree and that basically contained the entire element, or we had to create a new element and insert it in the right position. Okay. I believe that we are missing a bracket because we had the first case. Okay. Any questions? So let's see an example. So for instance, I want to insert 101 into this tree. So this tree basically has all of these branches. The root is not equal with null, so it's on the else branch. The current is assigned the root. While the current is different than null, the element value, which is 101 in our case, is less than is not less than 60, so it goes on the else branch. If it's greater than 60, then the parent becomes the current node, current becomes 100, and we return back to the while loop. So now again, we do the same thing. So the current is different than null is true. 101 less than 100 is false. 101 greater than 100 is true. So now the parent becomes current, and the current becomes the right child of that parent. So now we continue again. Again, we don't have current is different than null. So basically 101 is compared with 107, it's less than. So now it basically sets the parent to be 107 and the current the left of that parent, which is null, because since current with the previous current was 107, its life child is null. So at this point, current is null. So we jump right to the end in the if statement. If the element is less than, if 101 is less than 107 is true. So the parent.left, because it's equal with the reference to a new tree node that contains 101. And we return true because we basically finished the algorithm. If you want to insert another node, like for instance 59, then you follow the same algorithm. So you again start with current 60, 60 is greater than 59. So you would go on the left branch and the parent will become 60 and the child, the current becomes 55. 59 is greater than 55. So in the next iteration, the parent will become 55 and the current will become 57, the right child. So we are basically in this loop. Now 59 is greater than 57. So basically it will iterate one more time. The parent becomes 57 and current becomes null. Since 59 is not less than 57, we go on the right branch and the right tree of the right child of 57 becomes the new tree node for 59. So that's basically the algorithm for insertion in a tree, in a binary search tree. Now, traversals. There are various kinds of tree traversals. A tree traversal is the process of visiting each node in the tree exactly once. You can extract the nodes for different operations. You can basically print them, or you can extract them in an expression, or you can do parsing with them, modify the tree, and so on. So really, by definition, it's just the process of visiting each node and collecting those nodes. There are several ways to traverse a tree. In order, pre-order, post-order, depth first, breadth first traversal, and so on, multiple actually. So we'll start with a pre-order traversal. The pre-order traversal is to visit the current node and then the left subtree. And when you finish the left subtree, you basically return back to the current node and you visit the right subtree. So you visit the current, for every node, you visit the current node and then it's left subtree recursively and then it's right subtree recursively. It borrows basically from recursion that you're in a node and you want to visit it with some order traversal. You first print the current node and then you call traversal for the left child and then you call traversal for the right child. For an in order, you would call first the left child, then you print the current node, then the right child. For a post order, you would first process the children and then the parent. Depth first search dips down, goes down into one branch. Breadth first search goes level by level. Okay, so we start with pre-order traversal, which, as I told you, is the current node is printed first or visited first, then the entire left child recursively, and then the entire right child recursively. So the pre-order traversal for these three would be 60 because it's the root. Then it's pre-order, so the parent is done first, then 55, then that is the parent of 45 and 57. Then you return back and you go on the right child. So it's 100, 67, 107. So basically in pre-order, you visit the parent first, then the entire left subtree, then the entire right subtree. And you do this for every single node. An application of pre-order traversal would be to print the table of contents for a book. If you look at any table of contents, it basically starts with chapter 1, then subchapter 1.1, then sub-subchapter 1.1.1, then its siblings, then it when it's once if I finish with one subtree, I go up one level, and I continue with the siblings of the parent node and so on. So a table of contents for any book that you have ever read is basically a pre-order traversal of the tree that is the contents of that book. Some languages use this pre-order syntax for arithmetical expressions. So for instance, Lisp S expression, which is basically a way to write calls, methods, function calls in Lisp. You first specify the operator, like for instance, plus, and then the operands, left operand and right operand. So it's really like a tree where you read the parent first and then it's left child and then it's right child, okay? The in-order traversal will visit first the left subtree, then the current node, then the right subtree. So for instance, for the in-order traversal of this tree, you don't read 60 first, you just go on the left branch. You don't read 55, you just go on the left branch. Then you read 45 because it's a leaf. You go up to 55. Then you go down to 57, you read the entire left subtree. So now you read the parent 60, and then you go and do the same on the right subtree. So you don't read 100, you go down on the left branch up to 67 because it's a leaf. Then you go back and read 100 and go on the right subtree, which is 107. So really applications of in order are what we are writing our way to write arithmetic expressions. Because really when we write an arithmetic expression like for a tree, we write it like operand, left operand, then operator, then right operand. So this is a way actually that maps very clearly to an in-order operation. Basically you have the left subtree, then the root or the parent, then the right subtree. And even these trees could be their own subtrees. So let's say 1 plus 1, everything plus 2. So the root of this tree would be this, the second plus, and it has a left child, which is plus between 1 and 1, and the right subchild, which is 2, okay? Now, for a binary search tree, because of the property of binary search trees that every node is greater than its left subtree and less than its right subtree, in order traversal would actually read the elements in sorted order. Because for every node, it first prints the left subtree, then it prints the node, then it prints the right subtree. So in our case, this is a binary search tree. It will read it as 45, 55, 57, 60, 67, 100, 107, which is actually in sorted order, as you can see here. Basically reading in order traversal, a binary search tree gives you the sorted order of the elements in the tree. Post-order traversal of a tree is to visit the left subtree first, then the right subtree completely first. You can do it recursively with the same method, post-order. And then finally, after you finish both left subtree and right subtree, you would process the current node. So for instance, if you would have a small tree of three elements, you would read the children first, 45, 57, and then the parent 55. And you would do the same for bigger trees. So it would be 45, 57, 55, 57, 55, 67, 107, 100, and then 60. Now, in some languages, actually expressions are represented in post order, due to the fact that when you read in post order and you have a specific arity for every operand or operator, and the operators are mandatory to have either a final node or operands, or basically the element is a leaf, they have a unique representation for any tree for such operators. So in some languages, they actually prefer to use the post-order notation, which is also called the Cambridge post-order notation, or the Polish notation, because it's basically in reverse order. You read the children first and then the parent. Another type of tree traversal is the breadth first search traversal. Basically, you read the levels level by level. First, you visit the root, then all the children of the root, then all of the grandchildren of the root, and so on. So you can basically think of this as having a queue. The moment that you process a node, you push all of the children on the queue. And of course, when you go to the queue to process the next node, you would take the first element in the queue. So you would take pull out 55 and put in the queue 45 and 57 after 100. So maintaining that queue would basically allow you to visit the levels, the tree level by level. Many graph algorithms use breadth first search to basically find the shortest path in a graph because it guarantees the shortest path. If I want the shortest path to one node that I, if I have duplicates in the tree, if I do level by level, I find at least one path that gives me the shortest path. And usually applies very well to graphs because in graphs you can have cycles and other basically loops that you have to avoid iterating forever. So this will basically give you a way to it to find the shortest path. Depth first search is actually similar to preorder traversal. So if you go depth first search on any branch, branch by branch, and you backtrack, this the breadth first search traversal, the depth first search traversal will give you 60, 55, 45. Then you would, if you didn't find the node, you would basically backtrack up, and then you would read the next branch, 57. Then you backtrack up because there are no more nodes there, and you read 167. Then you backtrack, and then 107. So really, the depth first search is preorder traversal. Again, some graph algorithms use depth first search with backtracking. So you try on a branch, and if you don't find what you were looking for in the graph, you would backtrack to the parent node, and then you would basically try another path. And if you didn't find there, you basically backtrack. If there are no more children, you backtrack again up to when you get to the root and so on. Now, trees are extremely useful for representing expressions. So when any parser that reads an expression like addition between two operands, one and two, or an addition between a multiplication and let's say a division, it's a tree internally. And in order to remember how to actually read pre-order, post-order, and in-order, it's actually good to read such trees of expressions. So for instance, a pre-order reading of this tree would be basically plus for the operator, then the left subtree, then the right subtree. So this is what Lisp is using for expressions. Arithmetic expressions, basically plus of one and two. In order is what we are used to when we have an operand, then the operator, then the operand. So in this case, in order, we would read the left child first, then the root plus, then the right child. Post order means that you finish the children because before you read the parent. So it would be one, two, and then plus. Another advantage of post order is that you can actually use a stack. So you can push one on the stack, then you can push two on the stack. Then when you get an operator like plus with two arguments, you pop from the stack the left the right operand, and then the left operand. So, and if you use a stack like this, you can basically push on the stack all elements and then easily parse in constant time the expression. Okay. So we'll now we'll try to implement our trees and binary search trees. So like any other data structure that we did this semester, we'll start with an interface first. And because we'll try to implement the standard collections, Java collections, we'll basically implement iterable. And this is the iterable interface, which requires an iterator. And our tree interface extends iterable, and it defines all of the methods available for binary search trees in our case. Search for an element and returns Boolean. Insert an element and returns if it was successful or if it was a duplicate. Delete, which is a harder method that we'll actually learn later a little bit. In order, which prints the nodes in order traversal. Pre-order, that prints them in pre-order traversal. Post-order, that prints them in post-order traversal, first the children and then the parent. Get size, which returns the number of elements in the tree. You can keep them as a number, like a variable of the type int. Is empty, that returns a Boolean if the tree is empty, the root is null or not. And clear, basically clears the tree, assigns null to the root. And then we implement our abstract tree class, which are partial implementations of the tree. So this is the interface with all of the methods that we have seen. It's search, insert, delete, pre-order, in-order, post-order, get size, is empty. And then we have the abstract class, abstract tree, which basically defines the methods available for trees. Pre-order, in-order, post-order, and is empty, which basically it's concretely implemented by calling get size and comparing it to zero. Now, our binary search tree will be a subclass of the abstract tree. So basically it will be a class that uses the tree node with the left and right references to implement the tree. So the root is an element of the a variable of the type tree node. And we can now start initializing that tree node with elements that are inserted in the tree. I will implement three methods, particularly in addition to the ones that I inherit from abstract tree. Those are a constructor for a binary search tree with a null root. One is a constructor that takes an array of elements and iterates through them, and for each one of them, it inserts them. Inserts them into the binary search tree, and a method path that given an element, it returns in a list the path from that element to the root. So it basically finds the path, because this is a binary search tree. I can start from the root and go on each branch left or right until based on the value of the element. If it's less than the parent, then it goes on the left branch. If it's greater than the parent, then it goes on the right branch. If it's the equal with the value in that in the element of the current node, it returns the path, which is a list of the tree nodes from the root to the element that I basically I'm looking for. So this is the BST class. So basically I start with two data fields, root, which is of the type tree node, and size, which is an integer assigned zero. And I have the constructors, the default empty constructor, and the constructor that takes an array of elements of the type E and iterates through those elements and inserts every object in the current class. So the first method that I implemented is the search method. Takes an element, it assigns to the current root, exactly the algorithm that we saw before. If it's the element is less than that current element, the current element is assigned current.left and the while loop continues. One thing that you have to be aware of this is that the type of elements that we have in this tree are comparable. So we are using the compare to method to compare the key that we want to insert or find in the tree with the element in the current node. So this is the tree class that I'm using. I'm using a static subclass, inner class called tree node, which basically is going to be used for creating the nodes that are going to put in this tree. And it is a static class because basically I don't need access from the inner class to the outer class for any one of the members. I also created the create new node, but really what it does, it takes the element and it creates a tree node that contains that element and returns the reference to the tree node. I could have used new tree node wherever I use create new node for inserting elements. So now the insert method. So this is the implementation. It basically takes an element E. If the root is null, it just creates that new node with a new tree node and assigns the reference to the root and it returns. Otherwise, and I basically also increment the size with one. That's because I have this variable size that contains the nodes in the current tree. Otherwise, I need to locate the parent node. So the parent is assigned null, the current is assigned the root. In a while loop, while the current is different than null, I compare E with the current element. If it's less than zero, then the parent becomes current and the current becomes current dot left. And similar, if the current element compared with the element compared with the current element is greater than zero, that means that the element is greater than the current element and we go on the right branch. If the two elements are equal, neither less nor greater, then we return false because duplicates cannot exist in binary search trees. Once we found the element, we return current null and we basically come to this if statement. We compare the element with the element in the parent. If E is less than the element in the parent, we basically, the left node is assigned the new create node for the element E. So it's a new tree node that contains the element E. Otherwise, the parent dot right is the reference to the new node that contains the element E because E is greater than the parent is. E compared with the parent element is not less than zero. In either case, that basically I had the null tree or that I inserted the node in the correct place, I increment the size with one and I return true. Now I have the different versions of traversals. So preorder calls the helper method preorder for the root node. And now in the for that node, if the node, the root is null, we return nothing. Basically, there is nothing to print. Otherwise, we print in preorder. We print the root element first, then we call preorder for the left tree, then preorder for the right tree. So it basically preorder means present first the current node, then its left subtree, then its right subtree. And similarly, in order would do something similar. If the root is null, we return, but otherwise we call in order traversal for the left subtree, then we print the current element, then we call the in order traversal for the right subtree. And we do this on all the branches. So we start from the root and then basically we start iterating to the left subtrees until we reach leaves and we print them. Then we iterate to the right subtrees. For post order, first you call the method post order for the left subtree and the right subtree, and only then you print the root element. Okay. I will do the path in a couple of seconds. I want to show you an example first. So this is an example that basically inserts in the tree nodes and we want to traverse them in order, post order and so on. And we are using just lexicographical order. We compare the strings by their characters. So as you can see here, what does it happen? So if we have an empty tree, let me actually use paint to show you what's happening. So the first thing that happens, it creates, so we have a tree, there was nothing yet in that tree and we insert George into it. So the root was before null. And now because we want to insert the node George, we basically create a node with two null children. So you can basically consider that here. There are two children, they are both null, and the root is referencing to this root node, okay? Then we insert Michael. So insertion basically works the same way. So Michael is greater than George, the root is first, the current is assigned the root, George is greater than, less than Michael, so it basically creates a new node, and this will be the node for Michael. And we have a reference from the right subtree of the parent to this Michael subtree. And it also has two subchildren, which is the left side and the right side. So when we continue, so now we want to insert Tom. So Tom is greater than George, we go on the right branch. Tom is greater than Michael, we go on the right branch, it's null. So we can create the new node that contains Tom. Okay. So this would be Tom. And again, it has two children. And the two children are basically both null initially. So the next node that is introduced is Adam. So Adam is greater than, is less than George. So now we basically can create here the tree node for Adam. So in the order, it depends in the what order you insert the elements, because now we can basically insert Adam as a subchild of George. And we continue the same. So now Jones J is greater than George, but less than Michael. So we are going to put it right here. Oops. So this is Jones. And is on the left subtree of Michael. And again, it will also have left subtree child and right subtree child. And the same with Adam that we created previously. So now the next one is Peter. So Peter is greater than George, Peter is greater than Michael, Peter is less than Tom. So basically we are going to insert it as a life child of Tom. So somewhere here. So this will be Peter. Peter. And we have the left reference of Tom going to Peter. Okay. So again, now the next node that is included is Daniel. Daniel is less than George, but greater than Adam. So Daniel will be somewhere here. This is Daniel, and we can basically see that Daniel is a child of Adam on the right child. Okay. So now we print the in-order traversal of this. So the in-order traversal, let me just write it down. So in order, this will basically be George. In order, it's in order is Adam, then Daniel, then we go up to George, then we read the entire left subtree. Then for in order, we read first Jones. Then we basically read in order the parent, Michael. Then we read Peter. And we read Tom. Pre-order. Basically says read the parent first, then the left child, then the right child. So it would be George, Adam, Daniel. In the right branch, in pre-order, we have Michael, Jones, Tom, and Peter. Okay. And now in post-order, it basically means read the children completely, then the parent. So in our case, would be Daniel, Adam, then the other child it will be Jones, Peter, Tom, Michael, and George. Did I miss something in pre-order? So we read the parent first, George, then Adam, then Daniel, were parents before the children. So Michael, Jones, Tom, and Peter. For post-order, we read the children first. So we read Daniel, then Adam, then Jones, then Peter, Tom, and only then Michael and George. For in order, we have to read the entire left tree, then the right, then the root, then the right tree. So, and for here, we have no left tree for Adam. So basically, we read nothing, then Adam, then Daniel. Since now we finished the left subtree, we can go up and read George, and again continue with the same algorithm. So for the right tree, we read Jones, then Michael, then Peter, then Tom. So for every node, we have to read completely the left subtree, then we can read the node, then we read the right subtree for in order. For pre-order, we read the parent first, then we read the left subtree, then we read the right subtree. And for post-order, we read the children completely before we go to the parent. So I believe it's actually correct, all of them. Maybe it's easier to read if they are in this order, pre-order first, in order, then post-order.
Professor, are all three of these techniques recursive?
All of them are recursive, but you can implement them non-recursively with your own stack.
Like just these three or like breadth first and depth first search included?
So breadth first search, basically you need a queue because you basically read level by level, and the best way to actually to read it is to put them into a queue. So the moment that you read, you start with the root, you put it in the queue, then you start taking elements from the queue, first in, first out. And the moment that you take an element, you add its children at the end of the queue. So for instance, I take out George, I put in the queue Adam and Michael. Then, so George would be first, then Adam and Michael are put in the queue. Then Adam is taken from the queue and we add to the queue Daniel, but we add it after Michael. So basically, that's why it's breadth first search, that you finish with one level, processing them, and then you go to the next level. So now you take out Michael from the queue and you add its children at the end after Daniel. So you would basically add Jones and Tom. And because you take out Jones, it doesn't have children. Then you take out Tom and you put Peter. So breadth first search, the best way to implement it is with a queue. Okay. Post order, in order, and pre-order, you can basically do them recursively, or you can use your own queue. Basically, what we are going to do for traversals, you can basically push elements in a stack. So you put an element in the stack and you put this other call into the stack and this one into the stack, and then you process them in that order. First, you take the element out of the stack. Then when you finish that, you would print the root. And then when you finish that, you will basically take the next element from the stack. Any questions? Okay, good. Let's do deleting. Any other questions? Good. So deletion is a little bit more complicated because you can delete a node that is not a leaf. So if you delete a leaf, there is no problem because you basically have the rest of the search tree. But if you delete, let's say, the root of this tree, what do you do? What do you replace it with? So this is a little bit more complicated. When you delete a node that has two children, you basically, the way to delete it properly is to go on the left child and find the rightmost child of that left child and replace it as the node that you deleted. So in this tree, if I would delete George, what the algorithm basically will do, will go on the left subtree of George to Adam, and then it will go on the right subtree of that to find the rightmost child, because George is greater than the entire tree here, but in our case, Adam is less than Daniel. So in basically, you will have to go on the this left child on the rightmost subchild, basically try to find the last rightmost ancestor, descendant of the left child. So you can take that value and put it in the node that you basically deleted. And then you can just continue with the child to point to whoever is the child on the left branch or even null for the node that you basically use for the node that was deleted. So I will try to explain to you this algorithm. To delete an element from a binary tree, you need to first locate the node that contains the element and also its parent node. So we'll have a variable current that points to the node that contains the element that will be deleted, and the parent that points to the parent of that node, because we are going to use it. The current node may be left child or right child of the parent. There are two possible cases that we need to consider. If the current node doesn't have a left child, and if the current node has a left child. First case is that the current node doesn't have a left child. So basically, we have a parent, we have the current node that we want to delete. This parent may be the left or right of that parent is pointing to the current node. And the current node has no left children. So basically, when we do the deletion of this node, all that we need to do is to reconnect that parent link to the subtree of the node that we deleted. So it doesn't matter if it's left or right subtree. All that we basically do, we skip the node that we delete. Now, if, for instance, as an example, we want to delete 10, and in this case, 10 does not have a left child, it only has a right child. All that we basically are going to do is to remember the parent of the node that we need to delete, in our case 10, and redirect the link from that parent, in this case is left, to the right child of the node that we deleted, in this case 16. So we just reconnect root dot left to the new, to the node that was the current dot right. And this is the tree that we continue with. We deleted an element in the binary search tree. Now, if the current node has a left child, so we have the parent, we have the current node that we want to delete. And again, the parent could be a parent either through the left link or to the right link to the current node. But the current node has a left child. On that left child, we try to find, we iterate until we cannot anymore, we try to find the rightmost child of that left node. So we basically iterate as long as current.right is, or temporary.right is not null, temporary will be equal with temporary.right. So it basically goes on the branch up to the rightmost subchild. What do we do at that moment? We basically take the rightmost subchild and take the value from it and we put it in the current node, because this was greater than all of the parents on that rightmost branch. Now we just reconnect the parent of the rightmost link to the left child of that rightmost node that we basically used to put in current. So what we basically do, we copy the element from the rightmost child into the know that the current that was deleting was deleted, and then we reconnect the parent of rightmost dot right to the rightmost dot left, which is basically this child that before was the left child of rightmost and now is the right child of its parent. And that algorithm basically deletes the element from the binary search tree. So rightmost points to the node that contains the largest element in the left subtree of the current node that we are going to delete. And the parent of rightmost will point to the parent node of rightmost. The rightmost node cannot have a right child because it's rightmost. It may have a left child. And we replace the element value in current with this, the element into the rightmost code, a node, and then we connect the parent of rightmost to the left child of rightmost. And we don't, in some languages, you had to do garbage collection yourself. You had to delete the rightmost node, but here you just leave it be. So here is an example. For instance, I want to delete 20, and that's the root of my tree. I find on the left branch the rightmost child, which was 16. I put 16 in the root as the value, and the right child of the parent of 16 becomes 14. And we continue having a binary search tree, okay? So for instance, another example, let's say that I want to delete 40. As you can see, 40 basically has a left child. The rightmost child on that branch is 30. So 30 will be assigned to this node that contained 40, and the left node of that will be equal with 27, the left node of 30. So this algorithm works any single time that you actually need to. Here is another example. We had that tree that we created by inserting the elements. So we want to delete the root, George. So it has a left child. We are going to find this rightmost child, which is Daniel. We put Daniel into the node that was George. It didn't have children, so Adam will basically be assigned to the left child of Daniel, which is null, which gives us basically this tree, okay? We want to delete Adam. There is no problem here. Basically, it has no children. We just make the left link of the parent Daniel null. We want to delete Michael. We find it has a left child, which is Jones. Rightmost child is actually null. So Jones will be assigned to the element that is in Michael, and the left link will be assigned the left node of Jones, which is null. So this is putting it together, the entire delete method. So we start with two variables, parent is null and current is root. So we first have to find the element. So as long as current is different than null, if the element that we are looking for to delete is less than the current element, then the parent becomes current and the current becomes current dot left. If the element that we want to delete is greater than the current element, we assign to the parent the current and the current current dot right. Else, it means that the element, we found the element that is equal with the current element, we break. So now we have another if statement. If the current is null, that means that we are looking for an element, but we reached a leaf and it's not there, then we return false, meaning that the element is not in the tree, we don't need to delete it. If the current has no left children, this is the easy case. So current has no left children, then the parent is equal. If the parent is null, that means that it was actually a tree with a single node, then the root, or basically we are deleting the root, then the root becomes current dot right. Else, if we compare the element with the parent element and is less than the parent element, it's on the left branch. So parent dot left is the current dot right, the current dot left. else the parent.write is the current.write. So basically this takes care of the root. If the parent is null, it takes care of the root. Otherwise, we basically redirect the correct child of the parent to the left or the to the right child of the current that is deleted. So basically it's the first case when there is no left child, is only a right child. By deletion, we just delete the current node and redirect the parent to the right child of current. Otherwise, if the current node has a left child, first we need to locate the rightmost node in the left subtree of the current node and also its parent. So we start again with two references, parent of rightmost and rightmost. And as long as rightmost.write is different than null, parent of rightmost is rightmost and rightmost is rightmost or right. Basically, we continue on the left branch up to when we the rightmost, when the right link is null. And we keep the two pointers, the pointer to the parent and the rightmost. Once we find that, current.element is rightmost.element. So basically we put the value of rightmost into the current. And now we basically have to eliminate the rightmost node. And this is done by assigning to the, if the parent rightmost right was the rightmost. So depending on what was the link between this parent and the left child, basically what was the, actually the parent.write will always be assigned to that left child, which is rightmost.left. Okay. So if parent of rightmost.write is rightmost, then parent of rightmost right is rightmost.left. And there is a special case when the parent of rightmost is the current node that we just deleted. And in that case, parent of rightmost.left is rightmost.left. So basically we redirect the current left to the parent of, to the rightmost.left. We decrement the size with one and we return two. Any questions? I have the entire implementation basically in the lecture notes and I will post it on Piazza afterwards. So basically, let me show you the implementation and Piazza. So first I have the tree, which is just the interface that implements iterable. And for that, I actually need to implement an iterator that I will show you in a couple of seconds. Then I have the abstract tree, which basically just enumerates the methods in order, post order, pre-order, and is empty. If the size is zero, it returns true. And then I have the binary search tree, which basically has the implementation that you saw with search and insert and delete. And the small test that creates a binary search tree and list the elements in order, post order, pre-order, the number of elements. And I have an example for deletion, which after I print the tree, it deletes one element at a time. First George, then Adam, and so on. And you can see what is the rest of the tree that was left. Next class, we're actually going to do animation, a little bit of animation, which basically it's implemented in JavaFX to show a binary search tree. And I have some tests for iteration and half-month code encoding. So one thing that I want to do is to give you the implementation of these classes. So you can basically use them for the lab today. And I will put it on Piazza. Good. So now let's discuss about the efficiency of these algorithms. So first of all, these are not balanced trees. A balanced tree is a tree that the left child and the right child differ at least by at most one. Either the left child is great, it's a little bit longer, or the right child of any every node is a little bit longer. But binary search trees, as you saw in that example that I showed you at the beginning, that you can create a binary search tree with a single branch, they don't have to be basically with a single branch. Okay. I hear someone. Do you have any questions, Theo? If not, please mute yourself.
No, sorry. Yep.
Not a problem. Okay. So one property of binary search trees is that they are not balanced, meaning that the time complexity is the worst time complexity for every one of these operations that we saw today, insertion, deletion, and traversal of the tree, and they will be O of N. For in-order, pre-order, post-order, and other type of traversals, because every node will be iterated over, O of N is the complexity. The time of the complexity for search, insertion, and deletion is the height of the tree. So for search, you go on a single branch, left branch or right branch for every node, until you find the element on one branch. The height of the tree would give you what is the worst case. But in the worst case, the height of the tree is O of N, because the entire branch, all the nodes can be actually put on a single branch. It doesn't have to be like the one that I made here, that I had a single right branch. I can have a single branch, but that branch could be in zigzag. So I can have, let's say, four, I insert it, then I have, let's say, a right node, like one, I insert it, then I have a left node of that, like three, then I have a left node of that, which is two. So it's still a single branch, but in either case, it's basically O of N to find if two is in the node, or to insert 2.5 or some other node that will be on the same branch. So the worst time complexity is still O of N because these trees are not balanced, okay? And the tree visualization we'll discuss about later. So let's talk about the quiz first. So the in-order, pre-order, post-order, breadth first search and depth first search traversal for the elements, you can basically do them. You can read them in pre-order. It will be George, Adam, Daniel, then Michael, Jones, Tom, and Peter. That's in pre-order. In order, you read first the left tree completely, then the parent, then the right tree completely. Since there is no left tree for Adam, you would basically read in order Adam, Daniel, then Jones, Peter, Tom. Actually, in order is Adam, Daniel, then Jones, Michael, Peter, Tom, and George. Let me spell George. Then for breakfast, for post order, you basically read the children before you can read the parent. So in our case, it will be Daniel, Adam, then Jones, Peter, Tom, Michael, and George. Basically, you read left child, right child, then the parent. So in our case here would be Daniel because there is no left child, then Adam. Then on the other branch, it will be Jones. Then in order to read Tom, you read Peter, then Tom, then Michael. Now we read all the children, so we can read George. Breadth first search is just level by level. So it's George, Adam, Michael, Daniel, Jones, Tom, and Peter. And depth first search is same with pre-order. Basically, depth first search means go on the left branch, then when there are no more children, backtrack, then you go on the right branch and you go on the left branch again and so on. So it will be George, Adam, Daniel, Michael, Jones, Tom, Peter. That's depth first search. Now, first question, the second question in the quiz, if the set of elements are inserted in the binary search tree in different orders, will the two correspond to the same binary search tree? And the answer is no. And I can give you an example, A and B. You insert them in this order in the tree, and these are strings, like basically A is less than B. You will have A as the root, and then B as its left child, right child. If you insert them in opposite order, B and then A, you would have B as the root and then A as its left child. And these three, two trees are basically different. Is the in-order traversal the same? So if you read them in order, it will be A, B. If you read them in order, is A, B, because basically you would get in binary search trees, you will basically get the sorted order or in order.
Professor?
Yeah.
So it was so when you even if you like enter them in different orders, the two graphs will not look the same, but they'll still be equivalent, right? Like as an isomorphic, right?
No, don't think so. Let me think of an example. So let's say that I have three nodes and I insert them 3, 2, and 1. And I insert them into, let's say, okay, isomorphic, not directed, definitely, but let's say that I have 4 nodes. Actually, because it's a tree, you can always make it isomorphic, really, but not isomorphic in, so first of all, let's consider that these are directed links, okay? Maybe it's, we are thinking of the same thing, but we can see through an example. So if I insert them into this order, 3, 2, 1, and then I insert them later into order 2, 1, 3. Okay. So I get 2 trees. So I get 3 as the parent, then 2, then 1. So this would be for this tree, no? Of course, you have to consider the links. So 3 goes to 2 and 2 goes to 1. And now for 2 and 3, you would have 2 as the root, 1, then 3. So it depends, what do you mean by isomorphic?
I think what, if I remember correctly, like isomorphic means that like
you can create a mapping from one
right,
graph
yeah,
to the other.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, for this one you can. Okay, so let's insert another node. So if I insert here also 4, maybe not. Let's see. What can I insert that a tree looks basically one is with children and one I have a branch here. So let's say that what do I need for 2.5, and for 2.5 it will insert it here. Okay, so let's say that this tree takes reals. So if I insert 2.5 in each one of them, now I would have 2.5 here, and I can see that I have a node with 3 links going out of it, 2. And if I insert 2.5 into this tree, 2.5 is greater than 2, but less than 2 than 3. So it's 2.5 here. And I don't have any node that has 3 links. So these two, you can't find the function that basically maps the second graph to the first graph.
Oh, I see. Okay. So that also means like if you do an in-order search on like two different trees and your output is the same, it doesn't necessarily mean that your binary trees are the same.
Exactly. Because the in-order traversal of both of these is 1, 2, 2.5, and 3. And the two trees are definitely different. And it's easiest to see through the fact that basically the first tree has this node that has 3 links out of it, but in the second tree you don't have that case. Good. So the in-order traversal, the in-order traversal can be the same, but for different trees. Will the post-order traversal be the same? No. For the same example, post-order would be BA, and the post-order for the first example in which you inserted B and then A first, and this is string lexicographical order, will be AB. So different traversal, different string for traversal. Again, for pre-order, same example. If you read it in pre-order, the first tree you would get AB. And if you read in pre-order the second tree, you get BA. So basically, if you order them, if you insert them in different order or only in order is the same. The time complexity for inserting an element in the binary search tree will be log of n if it's balanced. But in a general binary search tree is O of n because it can be a single branch. And for deletion, exactly the same thing. We basically have to pass a branch, and the branch could be the length of the tree. For balanced trees, both of these will be log of n, because for insertion, you would go only on one branch, and that's the log of n if it, the tree is balanced or complete. And the time complexity for deletion, you would delete a node, and then you would go on the left subtree, rightmost branch, you will collect that node, and then you basically assign it to the node that you deleted, and then you redirect one link. So again, in the more general case, it's O of n. Okay. I have some problems in the lab that you can start working on. Basically, the first problem is one method that I haven't implemented, Bradford search traversal. You can implement it, and my TAs will show you how to do it through using a queue. Because you put a root in the queue, then you start processing the elements in the queue. You take the root out, and you insert these children at the end. And then you take the first child, basically the next element from the queue, and you process the elements one by one from the queue until the queue becomes empty. And that gives you a breadth first search. The height of the binary tree, you can do it recursively. You can basically, for the height of the tree, you're asking what is the height of the left tree and what is the right height of the right tree. For each one of them, you go recursively to their children. And when you reach a leaf, basically the height is one. When you return, the height of every node is the maximum between the height of the left tree and the right tree plus one. And when you reach the root, you will return the height of the entire tree, which is the maximum between its the heights of these two children plus one. The number of leaves in the tree, you can actually do one traversal, like let's say in order traversal, and you count, you increment with one for every node that you find in the traversal that doesn't have both the left and the right child children are null. The number of non-leaves, it's basically you can subtract from the number of total nodes in the tree, the number of leaves. Another way to actually look at it is that a binary tree, binary search tree, with all the leaves at the same level, would basically have 2 to the power depth minus 1 elements in the tree. But again, this is a way for a tree of that is complete. And finally is a full BST is basically to find if it's a full binary tree. If you basically, it's a complete binary tree, you reach a level where all of the nodes are leaves in breadth first search. Also two methods that need to be implemented are clone and equal. So clone, you can do it recursively. Equal, you can also do it recursively. If the equal between the left subtree and the left subtree of another tree, and the elements are the same. Okay. And then there are three methods which basically you have to implement without recursion. You can use a stack, which basically plays the role of recursion. I want to see if you basically can do it, and my TAs will help you. That's all for today, unless you have any questions. If not, I will stop the recording.